So in the last class, we have talked about the basic notion about the differential amplifier. What are the advantages associated with a differential amplifier as compared to a single-ended amplifier? And more specifically, we have identified two different advantages. The first one was the immunity to the environmental noise. And the second one was related to the corresponding available voltage swing. Now, in fact, last day I have discussed about the common mode response to some extent. Whenever both of these two transistors are supplied with the same value of input voltage, that means we are applying V in CM, input common mode level, then what about the behavior of the circuit and what will be the maximum possible swing allowable for this kind of arrangement? Now, to start with today's discussion, let me just draw the circuit diagram first. The same differential pair, which we have discussed in the last day. In fact, these two halves, they are symmetric in nature. And we may consider that these two resistances, RD1 and RD2, they are having the same value so that the circuit becomes symmetric. And you also understand what is the importance of having a current source over here so that the output voltage doesn't depend on the input common mode level seriously. So we should have a current source, constant current source over here. Let this value be represented by some ISS. And I'm assuming that these two resistances being the same, that is RD, and we have a VDD supply over here. These are the two different MOS devices in the differential pair, and the outputs are taken from the drain terminal. So this is the Vin1, the input voltage applied to the first MOS, and this is about Vin2, the input voltage which has been applied to the second MOS, the gate of the second MOS. So both of these two MOS devices, they are operating in a common source mode. So the input is applied at the gate terminal and the output is collected from the drain terminal. And these two terminals are the corresponding outputs, Vout1 and Vout2. So in the last day's discussion, what we have done is we have considered that these two input voltage being the same. That means, as you understand, the notion of the differential amplifier is that the common mode level of the two inputs being the same. However, the signal excursion is the opposite and equal. So if this is the variation for Vin1, so this will be the corresponding variation for Vin2. So this excursion, this variation, if I consider that this difference from the common mode level, let this be V dashed, then this is equal to this much. And this common mode level being the same, let this be called like a V in CM. And last day we have applied this V in CM to the gate of each of these MOS devices and observe what could have been the possible excursion of the input common mode level. That means what could have been the possible allowable range so that each of these two transistors, M1 and M2, they are operating in the saturation. And moreover, since we are implementing this current source by means of another MOS devices, hopefully last year we have considered these MOS devices to be M3, the MOS number 3, and we have to ensure that since it is operating in the, or since it is used as a current source, so obviously it should be operated in the saturation region as well. So we have to find out the corresponding range of the input common mode level, which can make all these three MOS, M1, M2, and M3 in the saturation region. So we have already got that particular range for this input Korn mode level. So this is nothing but the input Korn mode level, VNCM. This one, this value. This one is VNCM. Now today, our approach is different. So today, two separate signal. Let this be called like VIN1 and VIN2. So these are nothing but the differential input, VIN1 and VIN2. And accordingly, the outputs will be developed over here, VOUT1 and VOUT2. And we have to find out the gain of the differential amplifier. So here, as you understand, the output is measured with respect to these two nodes. So if I consider this is D1, drain 1 of the MOS 1, and this is drain 2 of MOS 2. So this output, final output, is nothing but VOUT1 minus VOUT2. And the corresponding input is VIN1 minus VIN2. So therefore, for this differential amplifier, the gain of the amplifier, if I consider the voltage gain, this voltage gain is defined like this VOUT1 minus VOUT2 upon VIN1 minus VIN2. And so we have to find out this expression. So once again, we will follow two different approaches. Initially, we will start with the large signal analysis, this expression for the current and voltage, mathematical expression. And then after finding out the expression for the voltage gain, we will solve the same thing using the concept of the small signal equivalent circuit. So let me start with the mathematical model. Now, if I consider that these two inputs are VIN1 and VIN2, and let this potential, so this is nothing but the source of each of these two MOSes, and they are connected together. So one can easily find out that this potential is nothing but, I mean, the potential at this point is nothing but VIN1 minus VGS1, the gate to source potential difference. Similarly, this potential is also equal to VIN2 minus VGS2. Now, since both of these two quantities refer to the same value, so we can write that VIN1 minus VGS1 is equal to VIN2 minus VGS2, because both of them refer to this potential. Now, from that, we can find out VIN1 minus VIN2. This to be VGS1 minus VGS2. Now, let us consider that the current that is flowing through each of these two MOSes are being identified by ID1 and ID2. And since we're assuming that during the operation, these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are acting in the saturation region. So therefore, we can simply write down the expression for the current, which relate the gate to source voltage, I mean the overdrive voltage, quadratically. So we know that when the MOS is operated in the saturation region, then the expression for the current is given by half mu and Cox W by L VGS minus VTH whole square. So right now I'm just neglecting the channel length modulation over here. So this is nothing but half mu and Cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. Now, if I assume that the current that is flowing through this MOS is being represented by ID1, and the current being represented, I mean, the current that is being flown through this device is equal to ID2, then we can easily find out the expression for ID1 and ID2. So from this expression, what you can find is VGS, this gate to source voltage, can be represented like root over of twice ID divided by mu n Cox W by L plus VTH. Now, this is the generic expression which relates the gate to source voltage with the drain current, device dimension, and the corresponding threshold voltage. Now, if I assume that these two MOSes are identical, so we can safely assume that the VTH1 and VTH2 being the same. So accordingly, if I just put the value of VGS1 and VGS2, then the expression for VIN1 minus VIN2 can be represented like root over of twice ID1 on mu n Cox W by L. So once again, I'm assuming that the device dimension for both of these two devices being the same, and the oxide capacitance being the same, and the threshold voltage also same. So there is no change in the denominator. However, because of the presence of differential input, the current that is being flown through each of these MOSFETs are different. Unlike the last time, what in which case we have considered that if I apply same volt, I mean same common mode voltage, then the current being flown being the same. So here it will be like twice ID2 upon mu n C ox W by L. So we are in the process of finding out the variation of V1 minus V2 as a function of ID1 minus ID2. Because if I know ID1 and ID2, then we can simply calculate the corresponding Vout1 minus Vout2. Because we know that Vout1 can be represented as VDD minus ID1 RD, and Vout2 can be represented like VDD minus ID2 RD. It is quite obvious. So if we can somehow represent, so from this one can say Vout1 minus Vout2, that means the output voltage for this differential pair can be represented like ID2 minus ID1 times RD. So we are in the process of relating this V1 minus V2 with ID1 minus ID2 or ID2 minus ID1. So let me have this expression first, V1 minus V2. And since we have a square term over here, square root term over here, so let me just find out the corresponding square. So V1 minus V2 whole square. So you have twice ID1 upon mu n C ox W by L. So that can be represented by twice ID1 upon mu n C ox W by L. And then you have the second term, that is twice ID2 upon mu n C ox W by L. And then you have this third term, which is nothing but root 2, so that will give you 2 into 2, 4 ID1, ID2. So 4 root over of ID1, ID2 divided by mu n C ox W by L. Now these two terms can be combined together because ID1 plus ID2, this is nothing but the total current, and that is equal to ISS. So we can write this is nothing but twice ISS upon mu n C ox W by L. Then we have 4 root over of ID1, ID2 mu n C ox W by L. So from that, what you can do is we can multiply the numerator and denominator with mu n C ox W by L and keep this root ID1, ID2 in one side. So if we multiply, we have mu n C ox W by L into V1 minus V2 whole square, that is equal to twice ISS minus 4 root over of ID1, ID2. So if you I would like to take this ID1, ID2 in one side, I mean root ID1, ID2 in one side, then that can be written like minus 2 root ID1, ID2, that is equal to half mu n c ox w by l v in 1 minus v in 2 whole square minus ISS. Now, in the left hand side, we have square root of ID1, ID2. So, in order to make it in the form of ID1 plus ID2 and ID1 minus ID2, so we have to find out the corresponding square. And ultimately, it is nothing but 4 ID1 ID2 is equal to 1 upon 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square into v in 1 minus v in 2 whole to the power 4 plus ISS square and minus we have mu n c ox w by l ISS into v in 1 minus v in 2 whole square. Now this 4 ID1 ID2 that can be once again decomposed into ID1 plus ID2 whole square minus ID1 minus ID2 whole square. And you must recognize that ID1 plus ID2 is nothing but ISS. So this ISS square can be cancelled from both of these two sides. So ultimately, we are left with ID1 minus ID2 whole square. So I think let me write down the full expression. So ID1 plus ID2 whole square minus ID1 minus ID2 whole square. So this is equal to 4 ID1 ID2. And in the right hand side, we have 1 by 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square, 1 by 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square into v in 1 minus v in 2 whole to the power 4 plus we have ISS squared and minus we do have, let me just check what does the value, yeah, mu n c ox w by l ISS, mu n c ox w by l ISS into v in 1 minus v into whole square. Now this ID1 plus ID2 whole square is nothing but ISS square. So ISS square minus this one is equal to 1 upon 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square v in 1 minus v in 2 whole to the power 4 plus ISS square minus mu n c ox w by l ISS v in 1 minus v in 2 whole square. So we can simplify the expression for ID1 minus ID2 whole square, because ultimately this is our objective, to make ID1 minus ID2 as a function of v in 1 minus v in 2. So ID1 minus ID2 whole square is equal to, we can write like minus 1 upon 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square into v in 1 minus v in 2 whole to the power 4 minus mu n c ox w by l into v in 1 minus v into whole square. Now I think it will be plus. We have 1 minus, so this should be plus. And there should be another ISS part. So this is the final expression which relates ID1 minus ID2 with respect to v in 1 minus v in 2. Now we have to, ultimately, we have to find out the mutual conductance of this differential pair And as you know, mutual conductance is defined like delta ID upon delta V in. Now for a differential pair, it will be nothing but delta ID1 minus ID2 upon delta V in1 minus V in2. So that will give you the expression for the mutual conductance or transconductance. Now to find out the expression for this mutual conductance or transconductance, we need to simplify this expression to some extent. So let me just simplify this expression. Like if I take this part outside, 1 upon 4, and then mu n c ox w by l whole square, and then v in 1 minus v in 2 whole square. If I take this entire thing common, then what is left? Now already we have 1 by 4 outside, so there should be some 4 and some ISS. And since we have only mu n c ox w by l, so in the denominator, we should have mu n c ox w by l. What about the second part? Second part is nothing but we have 1 minus 1 upon 4 mu n c ox whole square v in 1 minus v in 2 to the power 4. So we should have only v in 1 minus v in 2 whole square. So we can represent ID1 minus ID2. So now if I call that this ID1 minus ID2 like delta ID, that means the corresponding variation in the drain current between the two MOS, ID1 minus ID2. And similarly, if I call that V in 1 minus V in 2 is nothing but the corresponding variation of the input voltage. Then for a differential pair, the input is nothing but the differential input. Today, we are talking about the differential input concept, where the corresponding fluctuation of the input voltage is equal and opposite. So the input, differential input, is nothing but delta V in, and the differential current, differential output current, is nothing but delta I D. So from this expression of current and voltage, which relates this delta I D with delta V in, if you would like to find out the corresponding transconductance of the circuit, so this transconductance is given by delta of delta I D upon delta of delta V in. Now before finding out the expression for this transconductance of the circuit, let me just write down the expression for this current and voltage. So what we got is delta ID whole square is equal to 1 upon 4 mu n c ox w by l whole square. And then we have some delta V in square. Delta V in square. And within bracket, we have 4 ISS divided by mu n c ox W by L minus delta V in. So before finding out the value of a mutual conductance or transconductance, so let me just find out the value for delta ID, which is equal to half mu n c ox W by L multiplied with delta V in and the term inside this square root. 4 ISS upon mu n c ox w by l minus, I think it should be square, delta V in square. So from that expression, we need to find out the mutual conductance of the circuit. So this is not the mutual conductance of the MOS device itself, because this delta ID when it is applied, or delta ID whenever we are finding out, this is nothing but the difference between the two drain currents, that is ID1 minus ID2. So ultimately, the GM or mutual conductance of the circuit can be obtained like del del ID upon del del Pin. So that can be written like, so you can take half mu and C aux W by L to be constant, and it can be taken outside. Now we do have two terms, these two variables. One is delta Vin, and the second one is the term inside the bracket, inside this square root. Now both of them are function of delta Vin, so we should apply this UV law of differentiation. So first, if I take this to be the variable, so first you differentiate this with respect to delta Vin, it will be 1. So you have this term only, 4 ISS upon mu and C aux W by L minus delta Vin square. And then plus, we can take delta V in, and then this term, so something to the power of half, so half into half minus 1, so 1 upon 4 ISS divided by mu and C aux W by L minus delta V in square. And then this entire thing has to be differentiated with respect to this one. Now this one is constant, 4 ISS and this part. So only you should have minus 2 delta V in. So from that, we have to simplify the expression for this mutual conductance. So what we find here is, so it's half mu n C aux W by L and then what you can do here is, you can take this part, so 4 ISS upon mu and C aux W by L minus delta V in square. So they're getting cancelled, you have minus n over here. So in the numerator you have 4 ISS divided by mu n C aux W by L minus delta V in square, and another minus delta V in square. So ultimately, the mutual conductance of the circuit can be simplified to, you have a half mu and C aux W by L, half mu and C aux W by L outside, and in the numerator you have this 4 ISS this part, 4 ISS upon mu and C aux W by L minus, you have 2 delta V in square. And in the denominator, you have 4 ISS mu and C aux W by L minus simple delta V square. So this is the final expression for the mutual conductance. Now, if I consider the value of this mutual conductance whenever there is an equilibrium, that means there is no difference between the two input voltages. That means Vin1 equal to Vin2, or in other words, when delta V is equal to zero. Now, with delta V is equal to zero, that means under equilibrium condition. Now, with now this is the generic expression for the mutual conductance. Now, with delta V is equal to zero, that means when we are considering the equilibrium condition, that means V0 is equal to V2, that means we are applying the common mode signal, then we'll find that the expression for GM is reduced to simply you have this part, so it will be only square root, and root 4 means 2, 2 gets cancelled, and you have only root over of mu n C aux W by L into ISS So this is the condition with or under equilibrium. Under equilibrium, when there is no change in the input voltages. I mean, V0 is equal to V2. Now, how to find out the expression for the voltage gain? So, as you know, already we have seen Vout1 minus Vout2 is Vout1 minus Vout2 can be written like we have already seen in some of the previous slides, the expression for Vout1 minus Vout2. Yeah, here we have seen that this is nothing but ID2 minus ID1 into RT. And in our discussion, we have thought that ID2 minus ID1 is nothing but minus delta ID. So therefore, this Vout1 minus Vout2 can be written like minus RT times delta ID. Now, how can we relate this delta ID with GM? So delta ID upon delta V is nothing but GM. So that can be written like minus GM times RD times delta V. And this Vout1 minus Vout is nothing but delta Vout. So therefore, if I consider the voltage gain AV, that is nothing but delta Vout upon delta V. So ultimately, what we find is minus GM times RT. So if I consider the magnitude, so it is nothing but GM times RT. Now with GM is equal to this one, root over of mu n C aux W by L into ISS under equilibrium condition, you can simply put the value over here and you can find out what is the expression for the voltage gain. Now hopefully, already you have seen different types of MOS amplifier. More specifically, you started with a common source kind of MOS amplifier, and there you have seen that the mutual conductance of the MOS gets multiplied with the load resistance RD, and ultimately that value is or can be approximated as the voltage gain of a common source amplifier whenever the source is directly connected to the ground terminal. Now for this differential amplifier, apart from this value for voltage gain, we find some other peculiar behavior. Now let me just try to understand those different behavior from the expression of this differential current. So what we find over here is, let me consider this particular expression. Here I see in this particular expression the delta ID, which is nothing but the difference between the drain current, that is ID1 minus ID2, can be approximate, can be made equal to half mu n C aux W by L into delta V into this much, into this part. Last day, we have considered the variation of this output voltage with respect to the input voltage, I mean the differential output with respect to the differential input. And if you can remember, we have gotten waveform like this. from the large signal analysis, we have called this axis to be V1 minus V2, and this to be V1 minus V2. And you have seen that when V1 minus V2 equal to 0, then the V1 minus V2 is also 0. And accordingly, the nature of something like that. It's not linear, but it's not linear. So when V1 minus V2 or mod value of V1 minus V2, when it is very large, mod V0 minus V2, then one of the transistors, one of the MOS, is becoming cut off. If V1 minus V2, I mean this value, if V1 minus V2 is much, much higher, then MOS 1 is on, M1 is on, and M2 is off. And on the other hand, when V1 minus V2 is negatively large, that means when V2 is much, much larger as compared to V1, then M2 is on and M1 is off. And accordingly, you can find out the expression for the output voltage. If M1 is off, let me just go to the circuit diagram. If M1 is off, this V out1 is nothing but simply VDD. And under this condition, the entire ISS current will be carried by this M2. And this V out2 is nothing but VDD minus ISS into RD. Similarly, when M2 is off and M1 is on, then there is no current flowing through this MOS, and V out will be equal to VDD, and V out1 is nothing but VDD minus ISS into RD. So accordingly, we have got waveform like this. So it's not linear, but anyway. So this part is, I think, yeah. So if V1 minus V2 is much, much larger than this part of the waveform, you will find that there is no change of this delta V out with respect to delta V in. And accordingly, we have seen that. So this is zero, obviously. We have seen that when V1 minus V2 is equal to 0, that means when the two inputs being the same, then the current is equally shared. Assuming that both of these two MOSs are identical, then the current is equally shared by the two MOS devices, M1 and M2. And accordingly, ID1 is also equal to ID2. So last we have seen that when V1 is equal to V2, then only we find that ID1 is equal to ID2, and that is equal to ISS by 2, and V out1 is equal to V out. So that we have appreciated from our understanding on the application or the operation of the MOS devices. Now here, if we just consider this expression, now there is another implication which suggests that apart from V1 is equal to V2, there is another possibility where delta ID can be equal to 0. The possibility is that when this term inside the square root, whenever this term is becoming 0, one condition is that when delta V is equal to 0, then obviously delta ID is equal to 0. That is quite obvious, and we have already explained that issue last day, that if delta V is equal to 0, then obviously delta ID is also 0. But apart from that, whenever this term inside the square root, whenever this becoming 0, then also delta ID is equal to 0, as far as the mathematics says. Now let me just find out that issue. So what is there inside the parenthesis? So inside the parenthesis, I mean, we have the term inside the square root is nothing but 4 ISS divided by mu n C ox W by L minus delta V in square. Let me check once again. Yes, 4ISS mu n cox w n minus delta v n square. So whenever this term is becoming zero, then also as far as the equation is concerned, then also this delta id is equal to zero. Now from that we can find out the expression for delta v in. So that delta v in is given by root over of 4ISS upon mu n cox w by l. So the equation suggests that when delta v in, that means the difference between the two inputs, is equal to 4IS square root of 4ISS upon mu n cox w by l, this much. Or let me call this as let it be say delta v in dashed. Delta v in dashed, that particular thing. So when delta v in is equal to delta v in dashed, then also I delta id is equal to zero. That means id one is equal to id two. But is that really true? So we have to answer that question. Now to answer that question, once again we have to go back to the expression for the mutual conductance. Now in the expression for the mutual conductance of the circuit, what we find is the mutual conductance is given by half mu n cox w by l into this parameter. Now obviously this mutual conductance gm is becoming zero when the term in the numerator is becoming zero. So mutual conductance is becoming zero when this term in the numerator is becoming zero, because this half mu n cox w by l is non-zero quantity. So whenever this part is equal to zero, then the mutual conductance can be equal to zero. Now what is that value? So from that expression we find that when delta v in is equal to, so 2 4, so square root of 2ISS upon mu n cox w by l, when delta v is equal to this much, because you have the every control over delta v, because delta v is nothing but the input voltage or difference of the input voltage that you are applying. So you have the every control over this delta v, and accordingly whenever you are just changing the value of delta v or you are changing the value of individual v in 1 and v in 2, accordingly you have to observe the corresponding behavior of the circuit. And one thing you have to keep in mind that everywhere for the faithful operation of the circuit, it should be operated in the saturation region. Now what we find, if delta v is equal to this much, then gm is becoming zero. Now what is the implication of having gm is equal to zero? The implication is that, in fact, we should say that this is not delta v, rather this, accordingly we should have the positive delta v and negative, so we should write that this should be mod of delta v. Because if delta v is equal to minus of this much, then also the term in the numerator is becoming zero. So there is a two possibility: either v in 1 minus v in 2 is equal to this much, either v in 1 minus v in 2 is equal to this much, or v in 2 minus v in 1 is equal to this much. In both of these two cases we find that this mod delta v is equal to this much, it leads to gm equal to zero. Now what is the physical implication of having gm equal to zero? So gm is nothing but it's a parameter which relates the corresponding change in the output current because of the change in the input voltage. Now here, since we are dealing with the differential amplifier, so we should not say output current, rather the difference in the output current, that means delta id, and the corresponding change in input voltage is referred like the change in the differential input voltage. So if gm is equal to zero, it signifies that even with the corresponding change in the input voltage, there is no change occurring in the output current. That means the notion of amplification is lost when we find gm is equal to zero. Now if we just very quickly draw the diagram, the waveform over here, you find that it looks something like that. Suppose this is the axis for delta v in, and this is the mutual conductance gm. We find that if we just plot this one for different value of delta v in, you'll find that it is something like that, this gm. And if I call this value root over twice ISS, if I call this value to be like delta Vin star, then this is equal to delta Vin star. And this is equal to minus delta Vin star. So when mod delta Vin exceeds this value, delta Vin star, when mod delta Vin exceeds this value, then the mutual conductance becoming zero. Now what is the implication of having mutual conductance becoming zero is that the amplifier or the this differential amplifier in this case will no longer be able to amplify the differential signal. So we have got one notion about this delta Vin star over here. Now already in this slide we have discussed what is meant by or what is given by delta Vin dashed. Now in this slide let me just point out these two value once again. Delta Vin star, so delta Vin star was given like root over of twice ISS divided by mu and cox W by L. And here we already noted delta Vin dashed is equal to root over of 4 ISS divided by mu and cox W by L. And apparently it is clear that delta Vin dash is greater than delta Vin star. Now, whenever the input voltage, I mean the differential input voltage here, reaches delta Vin star, then what happens with the change in the input voltage? Even if you go on increasing the value of delta Vin over here beyond this point, even if you go on changing the value of delta Vin beyond this point, you find that there is no change in the delta ID, the differential output current, and which leads to Gm equal to zero. Now, what could have been the possible reason behind that? The reason is that when the Vin value, I mean the delta Vin value, when it is pretty large or when it exceeds delta Vin star, one of the MOS is becoming off. Now, since delta Vin is nothing but Vin 1 minus Vin 2, now if that value is very, very large, so it suggests that when it exceeds this delta Vin star, then M2 is becoming off. And as a matter of fact, the entire current ISS is being carried out by M1 only. Similarly here, when delta Vin is less than minus delta Vin star at this particular end, you find that M1 is becoming off and the entire current is being carried out by M2 only. So the total current, if I consider to be ISS, then this total current is being carried out by M1 beyond this point and by M2 beyond this point. So if you just calculate the difference, so you find that the difference is becoming fixed. ISS minus zero, that is ISS, or zero minus ISS, that is minus ISS. So beyond these two points, even if you change the value of delta V in, you will see that there is no change in the output is being reflected. And at this moment, we say that the linearity of the circuit operation is lost. Perhaps you understand what is meant by a linear circuit or what is meant by a linearity of a system. If I apply two different input and the corresponding outputs are generated, and if I apply the combined input together, then the final output is nothing but the summation of the individual outputs. Now here, for the circuit to be linear, for its linear operation, the GM should be non-zero so that it can amplify the signal. And that is the notion. So always we are in the process of designing linear amplifier. So everywhere you have to expect that the GM should be non-zero. Now when the GM becoming zero, that means out of the two transistors, one is becoming off and the other one is carrying the full current. And so our purpose of having a differential amplifier is lost. So every time you must restrict your operation within this range of the input voltage. So once again, it will give you the maximum permissible range for the differential input. So what could have been the possible maximum permissible range for the differential input? So this is given by delta V in star. So you cannot use any value. So last day we have seen what could have been the possible maximum and minimum value for the input common mode level. We have got a range like this. So delta V in CM should be less than this and should be greater than this. And today we are just finding out the possible variation of delta V in. What could have been the maximum allowable variation for delta V in? So if you select any value of delta V in which is higher than delta V in star, then obviously the purpose of amplification is lost and the linearity of the circuit operation is lost. Now coming back to this slide once again, you find that this delta V in dashed is greater than delta V in star. And when the input voltage variation, I mean this delta V in, when it exceeds delta V in star, so one of the devices is off. And our entire derivation was carried out on the assumption that both of the transistors are operating in the saturation region. So therefore, this expression is becoming invalid beyond delta V in star. So there was a fallacy that you might think that the delta ID, that means the differential output current, would have been equal to zero for delta V in to be delta V in dashed. But it's a fallacy because this expression itself will be invalid for any value of delta V which is greater than delta V in star. Now, if we just once again consider this variation of GM with respect to delta V. So as you know that our objective should be to operate the device or operate the entire circuit in the saturation region. So both of these two MOSFETs will be in the saturation region. And accordingly, we should expect that this delta V in star, that means the maximum possible allowable range for the differential input should be as large as possible. That should be the aim of the circuit designer. So we should expect that delta V in star should be as high as possible. So now let us just try to see what is the expression for delta V in star. So we find that delta V in star is given by this much, twice ISS divided by mu n Cox W by L. That is one thing. Now what is the scenario under equilibrium condition? Once again, let us very quickly look into that. Let me first write down the expression for delta V in star. That is the maximum possible range for the input voltage, I mean the differential input voltage. So that is nothing but twice ISS upon mu n Cox W by L. Now under equilibrium condition, as you know, both of these two MOS devices, they are carrying equal amount of current, ID1 and ID2, they are same. So under equilibrium, ID1 is equal to ID2, that is equal to ISS upon 2. And then what you can write is, this ISS upon 2 can be written like half mu n Cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square if I just neglect the channel and modulation. Now this is true for both the first MOS and the second MOS. So this can be true for one as well as for two. So from that you can find out the overdrive voltage VGS minus VTH for any of the two MOSes, either one or two, can be written like root over of ISS upon mu n Cox W by L. Now you see, under equilibrium condition, the overdrive voltage, what we have is having a serious relationship with this delta V in star. So more specifically, that is nothing but under equilibrium condition, the overdrive voltage for each of these two MOSFETs can be written like delta Vin star by root 2. So if you make any attempt to increase the delta Vin star so as to enhance the possible range for the input differential voltage, then on the other hand, it will also increase the overdrive voltage for each of these two MOSFETs. And even for a fixed current source, if I consider that the current source, I mean IHS, is fixed, then there is only one possibility by means of which you can increase this delta Vin star. The possibility is that we are considering that the oxide capacitance and this mu n is constant. So obviously, to increase this delta Vin star, the only option that is available to you is to reduce the value of the W by L, that means the device dimension. So if you just reduce the device dimension, then only for a fixed current source, you can increase the value of delta Vin star. Otherwise, if you do not change this W by L ratio, then obviously just by increasing the current source value, ISS value, obviously you can increase the maximum allowable input voltage, I mean the differential input voltage, over which the circuit can be used safely. Now we have from this large signal analysis, so we have got an expression for this voltage gain, that is AV. Now let me just very quickly draw the small signal model of this differential pair, and accordingly let us try to find out the expression for this voltage gain from that aspect too. So for that let me once again draw the same differential pair, and let us assume that the circuit operates in the linear region, because now we have two different input signal like Vin1 and Vin2, and the output at two different drain terminal. If I consider the drain 1 and drain 2, so that can be computed by means of superposition. So let me explain after complete drawing the circuit. Assuming symmetricity, let these are the same. So we have VDD. So we are applying Vin1 here, Vin2 here, ISS. Now we are assuming that both of these two are identical. Vout2, and let me call this MOS as M1, this MOS as M2, the same diagram. So here the output voltage for this circuit is nothing but Vout1 minus Vout2, so differential output. And we apply two different inputs over here, Vin1 and Vin2. So to find out the overall gain of the differential amplifier, this is nothing but this delta V out upon delta V. So what is delta V out? Nothing but V out 1 minus V out 2. And what is delta V? Nothing but V in 1 minus V in 2. So we will do the same thing, same calculation will be done using the small signal model. Now while performing this small signal analysis, now first of all we have to assume that only one input volt is acting, that means V in 1 is acting alone. And if I call that this terminal to be A and this terminal to be B, so accordingly we have to find out the potential at node A and node B. Suppose initially only V1 is acting alone, so you apply V1 only and find out what is the voltage at node A and what is the voltage at node B. Then you apply the second input, that is V2. So while applying the first input, the second input is considered to be inactive, that means it should be grounded. And then you apply the second input, that is V2, and make this terminal grounded, and once again find out what is the Vout, I mean what is the potential at node A and what is the potential at node B. And as you understand, the overall output is nothing but the summation. I mean, if I consider the voltage at node A, so this is nothing but the contribution resulting from the first input plus the contribution resulting from the second input. And same is the scenario at node B. And the final output is nothing but the difference between these two. So always we have to ensure that the circuit must be, I mean, the circuit operation must be linear so that this notion of superposition can be applied. So that has to be done with the aid of a small signal model. So while doing so, I think it will be better if I just go to the next slide and just apply the first input, that is Vin1 only. I think let me just erase that part. Yeah. So now you apply the first input, I mean Vin1, and we would like to find out what is the differential output because of Vin1 only. And because the circuit, I mean the circuit is symmetric in nature, so the corresponding output because of the application of the second input can be computed very easily. So we have a current source over here, ISS. Now this is grounded. So we are applying the first input only. So we do have RD over here and RD over here. And these are the two output nodes, Vin1 only acting alone, Vout1 here and Vout2 here. So one by one, you have to identify the effect of Vin1 at this node, at node A, and at node B. So let me call this, this is node A, this is node B. So these are the two MOS, M1 and M2. Now, as you know, for an ideal current source, the resistance being offered is equal to infinite. So whenever you apply some signal at the gate of the first MOS, that is M1, and you are collecting the output from the drain terminal, now what about the second, what about the role of the second MOS, MOS2 over here? As you see, the gate of the second MOS is connected to the ground. Therefore, the second MOS is acting like a degenerated source for the first MOS. So if I simplify the same circuit diagram, so it will be something like that. So we have this MOS as an amplifying device, and the second MOS M2 is specifically acting as a load over here, just like this. Let me just reframe the circuit, reorient the circuit. So this one is VDD, these are two RD. So this is the first MOS M1 where we are applying the input voltage, that is Vin1, and we will be taking output from this terminal, that is Vout1. So right now we are interested in finding out Vout1 because of Vin1 only. And this is the second MOS M2. So looking at this terminal, so looking at the source of M2, so this is nothing but a degenerated common source state. So if I just observe this particular part, so we have a resistance RD over here, which is acting as the load resistance, and we have a MOS M1, which is operated in common source mode with input applied at the gate terminal and degenerated common source mode. And the resistance of this source degeneration, RS, if I call, so that resistance is nothing but 1 upon GM2. If I just neglect about the body effect, then this RS is nothing but 1 upon GM2. So GM2 is the mutual conductance of the second MOS. And perhaps you can remember, for a common source stage with source degeneration, the voltage gain, the expression for the voltage gain is given by, so the expression for the voltage gain for a common source stage with source degeneration, so we can write down the expression for the voltage gain. So here it will be nothing but V out 1 upon V in 1. So this is nothing but the ratio of two resistances. If you can remember the ratio of two resistances, in the numerator you have the resistance as seen at the drain end, and in the denominator you have the resistance as seen at the source end. So at the drain end, the resistance as seen by the device is RD, and in the numerator for a common source stage, the resistance as seen over here is nothing but 1 upon GM1 plus 1 upon GM2. If I just neglect about the body effect over here, so this second MOS M2 is acting as a degenerated load for this common source stage. And this RS is equal to 1 upon, so I can write RS equal to 1 upon GM2. And the resistance seen at the source is given by 1 upon GM1 plus 1 upon GM2. And since it's a common source test, obviously there will be a phase reversal. So V out 1 upon V in 1 is given by minus RD upon 1 upon GM1 plus 1 upon GM2. Now, we have got one expression, V out 1 upon V in 1. Then we need to find out the impact of V in 1 at node B. So once again, I think I can use the same circuit diagram one over here. So here you see that whenever you consider the output at node B, then obviously it is not a common source stage. Rather, the output is obtained from the drain of the second MOS, for which the gate is grounded. Therefore, the second MOS is acting in common gate mode, common gate configuration. While the first MOS, if I just consider V out 1 to be the output voltage and the input is applied at the gate of MOS 1, so therefore this MOS 1 is acting in the common source stage. And accordingly, common source stage with source degeneration, and the degeneration resistance is supplied or is being offered by the MOS 2, and accordingly we can find out the expression for V out 1 upon V in 1. That is fine. Now, while we consider that my output is nothing but V out 2, while the input is V in 1, then obviously you must appreciate that since it is collected from the drain of the second MOS, that is M2, and the gate of the second MOS is connected to ground, that means it is operated in the common gate mode. And for common gate mode, you know that the input is applied at the source end for the MOS. Now, whatever the input being applied at the source end, so this is the source terminal. So what about the input over here? So if I consider this point to be, say, point X, then what about the potential at X? If I apply some input voltage over here, like V in 1, then obviously you understand that for this MOS, this potential will be acting as a source follower, because there is only difference of gate to source drop. And between this point and this point, there is a resistance. And that resistance is nothing but 1 upon the mutual conductance. So ultimately, if I just redraw the impact of V in 1, then we have a situation like this. So circuit can be redrawn like this. So this is the supply VDD. We have RD. So this is grounded. This is V out 2. And here we have V in 1. And because of the MOS, the corresponding resistance being offered is 1 upon GM1. So it's a common gate stage with input being applied at the source terminal. And the load resistance given by RD. So for this, if I would like to find out the corresponding expression for the voltage gain, so let me quickly draw the small signal model for this MOS, that is M2. So what you find is for M2, the gate is grounded, so it is at AC ground. So this is the source terminal, and let us call this drop is equal to say V1. And between drain to source, we have GM2 times V1. And this is the source end. So we're just neglecting the R0 and GMB part over here. And this is the source end, and we have this resistance and this V1. And this resistance is given by 1 upon GM1. And we do have one resistance, RD, connected at the drain terminal, drain and VDD. So in the AC equivalent circuit, it will be connected to drain and the ground. So this is RD, and V out 2 is taken from this terminal. So we find that V out 2 can be written like, we can simply find out, since GM2 V1 is flowing, since GM2 V1 is flowing through this direction, so therefore we can simply equate this output voltage V out 2 to be minus GM2 times V1 times RD. This is as simple as that. If I apply KCL over here, then we can simply write V out 2 is equal to minus GM2 times V1 times RD. Then the current that is flowing through this is nothing but GM2 times V1. This kind is nothing but GM2 times V1. So once again, if I apply KVL, this drop V1 plus drop across this resistance 1 upon GM1, and then this, if I apply KVL over here, then we will find that V1, assuming that the current is flowing in this direction, so this terminal should be more positive with respect to this terminal. So V1 plus GM2 times V1 times 1 upon GM1. And then plus V1 is equal to 0. Now then we can find out V1, the expression for V1 to be minus V1 into GM2 upon GM1 plus 1. So it relates V1 with V1. So if you just simply put the value over here, then ultimately we have minus gets absorbed, then we do have, so V1, so it should be GM2 times RD, and then V1 is nothing but V1 upon 1 plus GM2 by GM1. So that is equal to GM1 gm2 rd by gm1 plus gm2 into vl1. So from that we can simply find out this V out 2 upon V in 1 is given by RD. If I just divide both the numerator and denominator by GM1, GM2, then ultimately we have 1 upon GM1 plus 1 upon GM2. So in fact, the same expression what we have got last time for V out 1 upon V in 1. The only difference was that we have a minus sign, negative sign outside, because it was a common source change. So let me combine these two expression, and let us now assume that GM1 and GM2 being the same. That means both of these two devices are having the same mutual conductance. So with this assumption, GM1 equal to GM2. With this assumption, with GM1 equal to GM2. We find that V out 1 upon V in 1, that was like minus RD divided by 1 upon GM plus 1 upon GM. That means we do have minus GM RD by 2. Similarly, for the second expression, what we have got, V out 2 upon V in 1, we find it was like RD by 1 upon GM plus 1 upon GM for GM1 to be equal to GM2. That is equal to GM RD by 2. So when V in 1 is acting alone, what is the differential output? When V in 1 is acting alone, then the differential output is equal to V out 1 minus V out 2. So V out 1 minus V out 2 with V in 1 acting alone, and that can be written like minus GM times RD times V in 1. V out 1 minus V out 2 with V in 1 acting alone. So that can be written like minus GM times RD times V in 1. Similarly, when we apply the output, I mean, whenever, let me go to the main diagram, yeah. So we have seen that when we apply the input voltage over here and to make this terminal grounded, I mean, this point grounded, when this one is acting alone, then we find that this V out 1 minus V out 2 can be written like minus GM times RD times V in 1. Similarly, because by virtue of the symmetricity of the circuit, when we apply the input signal at the gate of the second MOS, that means at gate 2, so by virtue of the symmetry, we can say that then this V out 1 minus V out 2 will be equal to GM times RD times V in 2. We can say when V in 2 is acting alone, then V out 1 minus V out 2 with V in 2 acting alone can be written like simply GM times RD times V in 2. There will be no phase difference because we are calculating V out 1 minus V out 2, not V out 2 minus V out 1. If you write in terms of V out 2 minus V out 1, then there will be minus sign over here. So now the overall output, because of the presence of both of these two inputs, V in 1 and V in 2 together, so that can be easily obtained. So this V out 1 minus V out 2 Let me just once again, with V1 acting alone is equal to minus GM times RT times V1, and V1 minus V2 with V2 acting alone. It can be written like GM times RT times V2. So when both of them are acting together, then you can simply apply the law of superposition, and then the overall output V1 minus V2, that is the differential output voltage overall, if I say, or total, is nothing but minus GM times RD times V1 minus V2. So differential gain, if I call AB, that is equal to V1 minus V2 upon V1 minus V2. Sorry, V1 minus V2. Is equal to minus GM times RT. So the same expression which you have got using the large signal analysis, and here also you have got like minus GM times RT. So in fact, for a common source stage also, you have seen that the voltage gain is given by GM times RT. Here also, the if I just consider the magnitude though, the magnitude is given by simply GM times RT. So everything is fine up to this. But remember, there is one point which I want to mention over here is, if you just consider a simple common source stage, let me just draw it side by side. Let me consider a common source stage with, say, let me consider this current source to be, let it be ISS. We know, so this is VDD, this is RT, and we have V out from this terminal. So here also you know that the expression for the gain is given by minus GM times RT, and here also you find that the expression for the gain is equal to minus GM times RT for a equal current source, that is ISS. But here you have to understand the difference in the value, I mean Vin only. So here you have to understand the difference in the value of mutual conductance or GM, because you know that mutual conductance is proportional to the square root of ISS or square root of the drain current. We have already seen that mutual conductance in some of the initial lectures, we have seen that this mutual conductance GM can be written as a function of ID or the drain current. So if I just compare, so let me call this as say, let me call this as another MOS M3. So the current source being the same, that is ISS, so the drain current being the same, so the mutual conductance for this MOS is proportional to square root of ISS. And here the mutual conductance under equilibrium condition, as you understand, both of these two MOSes, each of these two MOSes will share equal amount of current. So under this condition, you'll find that the drain current will be equal to ISS by 2. The drain current is equal to ISS by 2. For M1 and M2, for each of them, the drain current is given by ISS by 2. However, for M3, the drain current is equal to ISS. Therefore, the GM for this case is proportional to root ISS. If I consider that other parameters are constant, like mu and Cox, W L is constant, then you'll see that here the value of GM is proportional to root ISS, and here the value of GM is proportional to, I mean, for both GM1 and GM2, they are proportional to root over of ISS by 2. That means if I compare the GM over here, so if I compare GM for a differential pair and GM for a normal MOS like this, then you'll see that this GMD is equal to GM by root 2. And as you know, depending upon the value of GM, the corresponding voltage gain will also be affected. Even if I consider same resistance RD value, then here the voltage gain that you are getting for a simple common source stage, it will be root 2 times higher as compared to the voltage gain as you are getting for a differential amplifier. So in order to have similar amount of voltage gain, what you need to do is you have to multiply, I mean, instead of ISS, you have to multiply or you have to increase the amount or magnitude of the current source. Instead of having ISS, you should have twice ISS over here, so that these two GM will be comparable. These two GMs are same. Otherwise, for the same ISS, then you find that this GM under differential amplifier mode, it is nothing but this GM normal mode divided by root 2. So therefore, the voltage gain is also getting affected. So this is one of the disadvantages of differential amplifier, you can say. But for differential amplifier, you have got tremendous advantages in terms of the swing of the output voltages, and the most important advantage is coming in the form of the immunity to the environmental noise. Since you are taking the difference between these two points, you are not taking the output voltage with respect to a constant potential. Rather, you are taking the, or you are considering the output to be the difference between the potential at two terminals. So therefore, the impact of noise or the effect of noise can be eliminated by a great extent. And this is the one of the biggest advantage of differential amplifier, which we have discussed in the last year. But as you know, in circuit diagram, I mean, in electronic circuit or anywhere, whenever you are gaining some advantage, obviously you have to pay for that. So here, the penalty that you are paying is that in order to increase the noise immunity and to enhance the swing of the output voltage swing, the penalty that you are paying is that the corresponding voltage gain is limited. So with this, let me conclude today's discussion on differential amplifier.